Okay, they got time to cancel, but they're still looking for security. Thank you, Mark. Please don't write any parts you can't metamorphose, can you? We should have him as an act in the bar. Anyways, at this point, without any further ado, please welcome Fabulous and Robin.
Heartbreaking.
wife just had a baby, Chan. Yeah. What a guy. I mean, one of the funniest men on earth, John Mercer. And really, if you haven't, if he hasn't come, I don't think he's been here at a convention or whatever, but he is truly one of the funniest guys. You want to get him on a stage, you know, at a convention sometime. That's a good time. He's the first Klingon poet I've ever met, you know? And probably the first Klingon lyric poet, certainly. I mean, be that to me. Not here about Herzl, the hell with Herzl. Who needs him anyway? You know, he's a Klingon. Where was I? I'm halfway in space. Wherever I was, it doesn't make any difference.
I'm sorry, John. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to say that thing. It's okay. I'm a stage-trained actor.
I don't need these things. Anyway. Somebody should tell the hotel or wherever the sound system that
you need a new outfit here.
That's right. All deeper. All right, so anyway, and then I told the guy that the next time I see him, I don't know what's going on. You know something? What might be really good? Because I'll go off on riffs. I have all kinds of stories to tell you, all kinds of weird things to tell you. And if you ask me questions, that'll set me off. I'll never answer your question, because that's where Garrett and I are totally alike. Basically, you know, right, so you'll never get the straight answer from me. But it'll be a different style. Anyway, I won't pick your pocket at the same time.
Have you seen any Lincolns lately?
Have I seen any Lincolns? This is, by the way, I'm going to remind the powers that be. What the young lady here is referring to is that the last time I read the Garrett's diaries was at this fan club gathering in Burbank, California, where I, you know, these diaries that I read, you know, they're kind of quiet things. It's not a lot of, you know, Klingons tap dancing and roaring for more blood wine, you know. They're sort of like intimate little affairs. And so we were in this hotel and had one of those sort of artificial dividers. And I'm right next to this artificial divider, reading these diaries. And next door, there's a convention of Abraham Lincolns. All these tall guys in stovepipe hats and, you know, beards without the mustache with that Abe-like. And they were all doing Lincoln talk over there. And it was loud Lincoln talk. And so the louder they get, the louder I got. Until I was screaming these diaries at the top of my lungs, and one of the Lincolns, I remember, I'm standing on, you know, my face is apoplectic and red, and I'm
Garrison took his sewing needle!
And so one of these Lincoln guys was then came to the back of the room, came from outside, and he's sort of like looking there, standing like Abe Lincoln, wondering what the hell is going on here, you know? And basically, I was too polite to ask him the same thing. Why 20 men would dress as Abraham Lincoln? But then I don't ask why 20 men and women would dress like Klingons, you know, and roar next door. But I'm polite. I'm from New England. It's as close as Canada as you can get, Maine, New Hampshire. And we tend to be polite, like Canadians. The farther south you get in the States, you know, the crankier they get. You know. But anyway. So now there is a line of that people want to ask questions. If there's not a line, yo, there it is. All right, sir, you're there. I'm here. And it's you, the night, the music. Isn't it romantic? See, that's the thing is. You can get into Garrett's sexuality, but remember, it's a family show, and the woman who's on her hands and knees is gone.
A question about Garrett. In the final few episodes where he was actively helping Dinar with the resistance, how did Garrett actually feel having to work with Dinar, because Dinar was the one who killed Z'Al?
Yeah, you know, it was an interesting, good question, because it was a very difficult moment at that very first episode of that run, of that series of episodes, when Kira, Odo, and Garrett go to Cardassia and first make contact with Damar's underground cell. And the writers, I don't know why they, you know, the writers
of course, it was such a... That whole thing with Poor Zial was such a botched deal anyway. I mean, three actresses, they never were satisfied with one actress, and it wasn't because of the actor's talents. It was because they just didn't know. At first, I think they were afraid that the actress was too young for Garrick, and then it'd be sort of like this bizarre relationship that, you know, Americans are strange about this stuff. Maybe you guys are too, but Americans are definitely strange about that. And anything, well, okay. Anyway, so you know, so there. This guy kills the love of his life, or the last love of his life. And that was, I think, before the hamster and after the loser. So there's nothing, no mentions, you know, like you dastardly pig, you murderous, lecherous, treacherous, you know, nothing like that. It's like, sort of, we stand and look at each other. So basically, I'm not talking about subtext, I had subtext coming out of my ears. I mean, basically, you know, looking at him, am I looking at him sternly enough to, you know, anyway, it was tough. And especially then over the course of it, as Garrick comes to respect DeMar, and then of course DeMar dies in his arms, you know, in that last episode. So that was a tough one, and I think the writers kind of dropped it there. I don't say that often about the writers, because I really do respect their work, and I certainly respect the work that they did with Garrick a lot, but that's not, I think, they dropped it. Thanks. Please, step right up.
Hi. Throughout your whole career, you've always played kind of bad guys or dark characters.
What would make you think that? I'm quite sure.
You started with Dirty Harry for me.
It started with Dirty Harry for me too. That was my very first film.
Have you chosen that kind of that side of the line, or?
Boy, a lovely question. But it's a good one, man. Thank you. In this life, I don't know what you choose. I think you choose everything, and I don't think you choose anything. I think, you know, it's in a sense, it's like, I don't know, it's all a mystery. It really is a mystery. Basically, I guess because there's a certain amount of intensity. When I was a younger guy and I had longer hair, my eyes may have been bluer, and I looked kind of weirder and meaner. I don't know what it is. It's probably an intensity thing that I would always end up with the guy who was. Like he had his finger plugged into the line, you know, like one of those cartoons, the perp line. And so, yeah, well, that guy, he's good. He can play the electrified Daddy. And then you know, see, the irony about Dirty Harry was, I was discovered, literally, the way they say, not sitting, you know, at a fountain at Schwab's drugstore with a tight sweater. I was discovered doing a play in New York. And this play in New York was an adaptation of the Dostoevsky novel called The Idiot. And The Idiot is the character who is the saint. It's Prince Mishkin. He's the saint. He's a Christ-like character. And he's so good for this world that basically Dostoevsky's dark view of it was that he has to be destroyed. He goes crazy and is committed for the rest of his life because he's too good for this world. Basically, it's the old joke about what if Christ came back? What if there was a second coming and Christ did come back? We'd probably treat him as shabbily as any homeless person. And so the director Don Siegel and Clint Eastwood came to see this play, and this is the guy I was playing. So they hired me as this psychopathic nut, which is probably tells them, you know, tells you what more about what they feel about Christianity than anything else. But be that as it may, I'm not responsible for their religious convictions. I'm an actor, and I show up when I'm hired and do the job. Listen, you don't know. This is stream of consciousness tap dancing today, folks. I don't know if you've ever seen this before. You probably have. Star Trek dancers are famous for their... Anyway, so, Star Trek dancers. Hey, bring them on, folks. There's George Takei. I can't catch up those legs. That dog. God, listen. Anyway, so,
in a sense, Dirty Harry, when you do, you see, what happens in this business, when you do an impressionable character like that on a big screen, and the show is popular, that's very important. Media, i.e., it makes a lot of money, which it did, and nobody knows that until, you know, the ka-ching of the box office starts, you know, sounding throughout the land, or lands, and so therefore they say, this made a lot of money, we'll not only make a lot of sequels, well, we can't bring him back, Robinson, because he's dead, but we can put him into a lot of other movies with ski masks and maniacal giggles. I cannot tell you how many movies, how many things I was offered that not only had the ski mask, not only had the band-aid across the nose, but had the same lines! I mean, these people's imaginations were so impoverished, they were giving me the same dialogue. Total charlatanism. So you turn it down. You turn it down as long as you can until you go broke. Irene's pregnant. We're living, you know, we're trying to scrape together. This is no kidding. We're trying to scrape, you know, together the rent. Went back to theater. You don't make a living from theater. Especially if you're trying to, you know, have a family, and our first kid is coming. So basically, so the you that I'm very sorry. I know. I'm very sorry. I do get carried away, and children do get very sorry. I'll try to keep it calm. I think we're all right now. I know. So, you end up doing one of these ridiculous roles to pay the rent. So, you're going to see a few of those, you know, and you're up at 3 o'clock in the morning and they're doing an old...
Oh, yeah.
You know, that actually was a good one. The one with Ruth Gordon.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was... Raise your hand, you said that. Where are you? Oh, yeah. That was a good one. And Ruth Gordon, who is like, you know, I mean, she's legendary. I mean, I was in awe working with this woman. I mean, you know, for those of you who don't remember Ruth Gordon wins an Academy Award. She's in her 80s, maybe. And she kind of walks up on stage and accepts her Academy Award. And she says, thank you. I just want to tell you that this is very encouraging. And she meant it. Here's a woman in her 80s talking like a young actor. This is very encouraging, she says. Hey, no, that was a good one. But there are some others I won't mention. But, you people, I mean, it's out in the airwaves. You've seen those, you know, A, B, C, D, and E, the fourth variation from the third side, you know, removed 9 degrees from the, without any underneath to the iceberg. What you saw on the surface is what you got, you know, that kind of writing. Anyway. I don't know if that answers your question, but that's tough. Yes, please.
Okay, yeah.
Well, great style. Okay. I know what I'm asking, Yo-Yo.
Antics, what is the most insane practical joke you've ever pulled, ever had pulled on you, most insane thing you ever did behind the scenes? So,
Dear. This is, oh dear, that question. Lord. Listen, am I going to talk about Sid Big putting the cucumber in his pants again? I mean, no, nobody noticed. Fine, he's wearing his tight white pants, sticks it down there, walks out, and everybody's shooting, the camera's rolling, nobody noticed. You know, so it doesn't make any difference. That's what a serious group we are. We're very serious. Oh, practical joke, how day class A, please spare us. We're classically trained actors. We don't indulge ourselves. Oh, please, they pay no attention to it. Maybe they'll go away. What, you know, why are you standing over there? You're going to get my left profile, which is the least interesting profile that I have. It's really, please. Anyway, next question.
Hi. I love DSN, loved your work, and I especially love watching Derek interact with Odo and Kira, and I was just wondering if you'd care to comment on working with Nana and Renee.
You see, the thing is, we are serious actors, and for the most part, the actors that were on that show, very well-trained actors, and people who, like, take their craft seriously. I mean, Renee has, I don't have to tell anybody about his credits. I mean, if I do, then you should go back to Baffin Bay, you know, and some Live in Your Dugout Canoe. I mean, basically, here's a man who's like, you know, it's like he represents almost like a cross-section of American theater. These are people that I loved working with. And then Nob, who's become a very close friend, is someone who is like, brought to Kira. You see, and they screwed around with Kira a lot. I mean, you know, in terms of like, it wasn't so much the writers, it was sort of like the executives. Well, she's not girly enough. We want somebody who's girly, you know? And so they'd stick her in these tight outfits, or they'd cut her hair, or they'd feather it, whatever the hell you call it, you know, so forth. But the courage, but basically she stuck with it. And you notice in somewhere in the middle of the series, you know, basically she kind of got mixed signals from the writers and the executives, but she stayed the course, and she kept that wonderful character, this woman who really is a warrior, and who was really an underground operative, and who did things that you had to do that weren't pleasant things to survive in the underground. Renee. Two things I can say about Renee is that I was one of the three people that came down as a finalist for Odo, and the right person got the job, really, because Renee, as an actor, really is a shapeshifter. I mean, he can just morph his, you know, from one character to the next to the next to the next, and that was the toughest mask of all on that show, because there wasn't a lot of flexibility to Odo's mask. Armin, myself, I feel that there was a lot more flexibility. But because Renee was playing an unfinished, so to speak, human being, that's a very difficult character to play. And a man, a character, a creature who's finding his soul, finding his humanoid soul, so to speak. All these actors. I will miss working with them. I am going to work with Renee again. I think Renee and I, I'm going to direct Renee on a play, Waiting for Godot, in Los Angeles. And he's going to be brilliant. We just had our first reading the day before yesterday. So yeah, I mean, these are people that I would cross the street to work with anytime. Thank you. Thank you.
Welcome to our convention in Toronto.
It's a pleasure to be here.
I'd like to just say that I think Garrick was a character that was really good in the effect that you could really, some things he did, you'd like to just wring his neck. Say, oh, he's terrible, you know? And then on another point, he'll come back with, oh, he's not such a bad guy after all.
Yeah, that's what he gets you too, baby. Then when you put your hand behind your butt, your wallet's gone. Yeah.
I wonder how was it to change, like, a bad guy to a good guy and vice versa.
You know, the thing is that thank you for the comment. It was written that way, and it was written, the guy is a professional spy. I just, in this book that I call A Stitch in Time, there's a whole, the book takes place, and I'm going to, you know, I think this will answer your question, well, at least answer it the way I can. The book is on three levels. The book starts from where the series leaves off, okay? So there's Garrick sitting on this desolate, decimated planet. It's kind of like one of the Kosovar people coming back to Kosovo after, you know, the so-called liberation. and they come back to not only houses and land destroyed, but families that they knew, gone, dead, dispersed. Everything has changed so utterly. And that's where the book begins, with Garrett coming back to his home, or what was his home, because everything's been reduced to rubble. It looks like Cologne or Dresden after, you know, the Allies, you know, blanket bombs those cities at the end of World War II. That's one level. So that level goes on with Garrick beginning the reconstruction, his reconstruction of the planet. How is this planet going to reconstruct politically, socially, as well as physically? So, and that was a lot of fun to like, and I must say the Kosovo thing was happening at the same time. So that had a lot of influence with that. The second level is Garrick, and of course Garrick is flashing back. And he flashes back to two other levels. He flashes back one level to Deep Space Nine, his time on Deep Space Nine. And I never get into stuff that episodes have dealt with, because the episodes have already dealt with that. And I don't like that in Trek fiction, where, you know, you basically have seen a show and then somebody writes their version of that show. I find that very boring, personally. And then the third level that he flashes back to is when he was a kid, and when he was a young boy, and how he was sent at a very early age to this school. And on Cardassia, I sort of established that Cardassia has an education system that's very much like a European education system, or some European educational systems, where at an early age you're identified as having an aptitude for this, that, or t'other. And then you are sent to that school, which is basically a trade school, whether it be military, or whether it's, in Garrick's case, it's an intelligence school. And they're run very strictly, obviously, you know, because the whole thing is very Germanic, very Prussian, it's very regimented, it's severe, the punishments are severe if you don't toe the line and so forth. So, when you understand, when you see how a person has been educated, how a person has indeed been conditioned to think, to feel, to behave like a spy, you can understand why you'll never get the straight truth from this person. And on the other hand, that's also the person's pain, because the person can never really connect with anybody. So there's a lot of pain in the book in terms of these relationships. I mean, with people that he falls in love with, that he is unable to make that kind of connection that's going to result, that is going to flow into any kind of fulfilling relationship. So it's not so much that he's a good guy or a bad guy. He is who he is. It's kind of like what Iago says in Othello: "I am who I am," or what Lucifer says, I think, at one point. It's not that I'm good, it's not that I'm bad. I am who I am, because I can't be anyone else. And that's basically one of the things, one of the major themes in the book is Garrick fighting against this isolation, the isolation of being who he is. And of course, with his whole parental confusion, which obviously, it's no secret to any of you, when we find out, as I did when I read the script, that indeed Navin Taine, as he's on his deathbed, is his father, then that figures into the book too, because he thinks someone else is his father. And you'll see some of that, if those of you who will come to the reading tonight, you'll hear some of that. So it's such an interesting character. And the reason this book, you understand, folks, the reason this book came out isn't because,
I think I'll write a book about, I'll put in my two cents with Star Trek fiction and write a book about Garrick.
Basically, what happened was that I would come to conventions, and there was such a interest in the character. See, this is what has blown my mind from day one about this trip, this Star Trek trip that I take. I was not a Trek fan. I never watched the original series. I mean, I channel surf like anyone else. You know, oh, there's a guy with the funny ears, and I'm moving on. Never got into it. When they offered me to, like, read for that episode, the very first episode, past prologue in the first season, and saying, what am I reading for? You're reading for a Cardassian. I mean, who the hell knew what that is? I certainly didn't. And then nobody else could tell me what it is. And then somebody showed me a picture, and I decided, well, yeah, okay, it looks like a cross between a lizard and Mr. Pickle. So, basically, I was playing like a lizard. And he's reptilian and cold-blooded. And, you have to grab those things just so you have something that you can play as an actor, something that you can come in and make sense with. And then I started writing stuff about the character. I figured, okay, I might as well give this character a background and fill in. You see, I had to because of the iceberg. I mean, you've got the tip, and the tip in the script is really very minuscule. I mean, it's nothing. So I have to fill in all that stuff underneath. So I started doing it with the writing. And then I started coming to small conventions, you know, because it's not something I could read in this room. It wouldn't, you know, it just loses something, you know, because it's not something that is dramatized. That's why I started reading it. And people really appreciated the information, the investigation. And then that's where the book came out of. You know, trying to figure out who this character is. And I am totally lost. I am totally free-falling in space. I've forgotten what was asked, why was asked, why I'm suddenly talking like this. And believe me, I'm not on drugs. This is a drug-free environment, and so am I. So, I mean, you know, but, you know, I'm an old guy. And it happens. It used to be a Rolls Royce of a brain. Now it's kind of a Volkswagen bus, you know, with a lot of hippie, you know, riding down. Yeah, baby. Hey, Ruben. All right, please, save me. Ask me a question and save me.
Recently you were on an episode of The Sentinel playing a much more sympathetic and straightforward character.
Boring.
Did you like the job?
Boring. It's a lousy script. Lousy script. Yeah, I know. I mean, the ATF guy.
ATF, you know, Dudley Do-Right.
On the Sentinel where you were the homeless man.
I'm very sorry. Yes, the Sentinel, not the pretender.
Yeah, right. Oh, yeah. That's what's called mic technique, isn't it? Pretty soon I'll be doing my James Brown imitation. It's a man's work! James Brown concert, three of you would be dead by now. The sucker go flying out there, it's a man! But it wouldn't mean anything without a woman. Okay, that was the next character. I like that character a lot. And you know, you see, somebody asked the question about, do you choose these characters? I don't choose them, but I love playing them. I love playing these people that, you know, you just kind of walk by on the street. You know, nobody pays attention to these guys who are sort of like there muttering and talking to themselves and who are obviously... And you don't. And you can't. I mean, you know, there's a lot of pain in the world, you know. We can't take on all the pain of the world. And in a sense, you know, this is what it is. And so... And it's dangerous, too. It's dangerous. It's sort of like you have to keep your distance from these people. In our country, our social safety net probably has the biggest holes, you know, since the 1994 earthquake. I mean, it's like, so basically, you know, during the Reagan administration, we just decided, well, you know, listen, just, you know, we're spending too much money on these mental health places. You know, just we can save a lot of money by just opening the door and just... Everybody leave, just go out and take care of yourself. So basically there are a lot of people like this guy who's like, you know, out there. And it's distressing. So, I mean, to play a character like that is a responsibility. It's a responsibility to play any kind of character, but especially when you're playing a character that comes loaded with that kind of information and that kind of attribution and association. Acting is not often not an innocent thing, and it's not an innocent thing. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. How did it feel?
You sound like me getting up this morning.
Yeah, I am. Okay, how did it feel looking at Cardassia after the mini trash ship?
And you know, whenever you're faced with something like that, as an actor, again, see, acting, in case you probably haven't already caught on, that's my passion. That's what I love to do. I really love putting together characters and answering questions like that. Because, you know, I'm in Dirty Harry, I'm not a psychopathic killer. I play Liberace, I'm not a gay piano player. I am in this L.A. wall with multiple personalities. I have multiple personalities, but I sort of like, you know... yeah, except when I, you know, get a little out of control, you know, and it sort of jumps out. But, you know, so you try to find the equivalent, the emotional equivalent, inside yourself. What part of you is a killer? In what situations would you actually take the life of another person? You have to ask yourself that question as an actor, otherwise you're a liar. It's, you know, I think you are. So if you play a killer and never investigate that part of you that is violent, that is murderous, and no matter how, you know, the dark side of you, in other words. So what in my life was equivalent to the fact of suddenly going home again and finding there is no home. And I did have an equivalent when I was a kid. I came from what they used to call in the 50s a broken home. A mother who was very sick, had a nervous breakdown, and basically I was sent away to this school, and much like, you know, because like much of the thing in the book about Garrick being sent away to the school at a young age is like certainly the emotional basis. I wasn't sent away to a school, to an intelligence school in Cardassia, but I was sent away to a very strict, you know, industrial school in Rhode Island. And the emotional truth of that experience is what I try to translate into Garrick's experience. And to answer your question about what was it like, because do you remember that last scene in the very last episode with Bashir, where Garrick is talking about what's happened to his planet and taking responsibility, how the Cardassians have to take responsibility. They can't blame anybody else for what happened. They can't blame the Breen, the Jem'Hadar, the Founders, the Dominion, whatever. They brought this upon themselves. It's like one of my favorite scenes ever for Garrick, and it was like one of the reasons I was so happy with the finale because of that scene. Other things too, I thought that 2-hour finale was a wonderful finish, and as we all know, sometimes 2-hour finales to a show that's been a favorite over several years can be very disappointing. This one didn't disappoint. But in the end, that very last moment was once when I came home from this school, and I don't know how old I was, maybe I was 12, 13, and I saw my mother, and for the first time, that was my first recognition of just how sick she was. Just how deeply unbalanced. And it was horrible, because I realized that I couldn't pretend anymore. I couldn't pretend it was this or that, or this or that, or this or that. It was like, there she was. And that was the thing that I used when Garrick is talking about when he recognizes what has happened to Cardassia, and he recognizes that he has to take responsibility for it. Thank you. Next question, please.
You touched on the Garrick Zial thing earlier, and this question, I hope it doesn't take too much away from the book, so I'm really looking forward to reading it now. But you said that the writers really sort of dropped the ball on the whole Zial thing. They didn't know where to go with the character.
That's right, yeah.
When they introduced the character of Zial, what did you think of the relationship between the two, being that Garrick is an older, extremely worldly man, and Uziel is a kid. She was fairly young and brought up under extremely strange circumstances.
You see, I had no problem with the age difference, that sort of, what do you call it, the May-September?
May-September.
Thank you. Right. And I had no problem with that simply because he is, as I say, he is such an isolated man. I mean, you know, check it out, folks. I mean, the fact that he stays on Deep Space Nine after the occupation, after the Cardassian withdrawal, it's like a member of the German Wehrmacht, you know, staying in Jerusalem or something. I mean, you know, after World War II. I mean, it is so bizarre and so such a difficult situation. So he is such an isolated man, and basically his main relationship is with Julian Bashir. But even that, after the episode Our Man Bashir, even that they sort of like let drift, because the writers couldn't figure out what to do after, you know, Bashir shot Garrick in the Holosuite program. You remember that? When they're in the Holosuite program and Garrick wants the bailout, but the bailout means that Dax and Sisko and others will die. And Garrick says, fine, I'm letting them die, I'm taking care of myself, and Julian prevents him by shooting him. And suddenly it's no longer the mentor relationship that they had. The two of them are now peers. And then the writers didn't know where to take that. So that further isolates Garrick. That further makes him a lonely, sort of like unfriended person. So the thing about Zial is also a fish out of water, half Bajoran, half Cardassian, with this insane father of hers. And there could have been, I think, a really sophisticated, a very touching relationship between them. Didn't that be smarmy? And I think fans would have accepted that. I mean, you know, they certainly weren't going to make it, you know, like, you know. So, but they didn't go that way. And then they tried to cast an older actor, but because they didn't go with their initial impulse, which is what I think it was. And they tried to, you know, just sort of fudge it, hedge it a bit, and hiring an older actor, then they lost it completely. Lost it completely.
Just a little bit lower. There we go. Sure, we'll look at it on the
top. Listen, I wasn't going to say anything. I know better.
You've spoken very eloquently about how you go about preparing yourself as an actor for a certain character, for a certain role, and you've also alluded to the fantastic actors that you've worked with on DS9. Given that, and given some of the wonderful performances enjoyed over the run of DS9, how come there's never been a hint of a whisper of any recognition through people?
You know, oh boy, I'll tell you. I'll tell you, because frankly, I'll tell you how we felt. We felt like the middle kid. We felt like the middle kid kind of got ignored. There was, of course, the original series is the original series, so they occupy mythic status in the Star Trek pantheon. Then, because there was a long hiatus before Next Generation was received, you know, and the Next Generation became a good show, and so the Next Generation then was accepted as, oh, thank God you're back. Then, there are two things that happen. Deep Space Nine comes along, and Deep Space Nine is no longer the one-night stand in a rocket ship, you know? It's this floating, what I call the floating arachnid, and on the edge of the frontier, sort of like, you know, inspired, I think, by the old Star Wars, not the new one. By the old Star Wars bar scene, you know, where suddenly every creature in the galaxy is wandering through this place. It's a real Wild West saloon. But it's not the classic Gene Roddenberry concept. And so I think that immediately alienated a whole bunch of fans and somehow made it kind of suspect, a little illegitimate, right? I think so. And then Voyager comes, and Voyager is classic Trek. It's, you know, the good Federation people, all due respects to those of you in the Federation costumes, It's the good Federation people, you know, and there's not a bad apple among them, and they're meeting these evil aliens and so forth. I find that black and white. I don't like that concept. I really don't. I myself, being the kind of actor that I am, and the kind of theater that I like that gray, morally gray thing that happened with Deep Space Nine, where every one of those characters, every one of those characters is capable of doing something that he or she does not feel good about. That one of my favorite episodes, for instance. Even the good, upstanding Captain Sisko in By Pale Moonlight. What happens with him and Garak? He goes to Garak and says, listen, Garak, why don't you help me out? I got a problem. Garak says, fine, I'll help you out. He says, okay, he says, yes, but let me take care of my way. Garak takes care of it his way, which is the morally repugnant way, but the end justifies the means, right? And the job is done. The Romulans are now in the war, on the right side, turning the balance, the power balance. Now, you're giving me 5 minutes? Good. No, not good. I'm staying up here another hour. Get out of here. Get lost. And Sisko gets drunk. I mean, it's a great scene. And those phenomenal scenes that Avery has when he's talking to the camera, I mean, it's like, especially at the end, when he's like, he realizes he's been besmirched by something that he can't clean off. That to me is drama. That's stuff. You know, but it's stuff that doesn't make, and I'm sure there are a lot of people in this room that you're not comfortable with. And that I'm sure that there are some of you here, and I respect it, believe me, that you're more comfortable with the classic Gene Roddenberry, in the 24th Century Federation, we have solved all the problems, and now we're going around and we're going to help other people solve theirs, but, you know, what is that, that's not first principle, what is this? Man, yeah, come here. You know something? When I was writing this book, I gotta say, I started writing this book, and I started, you know, because I'm sort of like a freewheeling, sort of like weird cat, you know, I started like making up stuff. So I sent the first 90 pages to the editor, and the editor said, no, Andy, this is Star Trek. Things have been going on in Star Trek for many years before you came here, and you just can't rewrite history. Would you write a history of the world and rewrite it? And I bit my tongue because I would have said yes. So, but rightly so. I mean, she was right to point that out. So I had to go back and do a major rewrite. And I had to sit down with the Akuda's encyclopedia and really, man, I got every reference book I could. So now I'm kosher. Just want to tell you that I'm kosher. And you know why I'm saying this. I have no idea. I thought I was going to get more on track. I thought, well, you know, you just get up here and just talk a bit, and you know, you'll be cool, but I'm still lost. I'm still lost. A lost Cardassian Taylor. Anybody got a pair of pants they need hemmed? All right, one more question, sir, and then we'll wrap it up for this afternoon.
Are you?
You know, but they gave me the high sign. I'm sorry. I'll be back tomorrow. All right,
you know,
the man, all right, what's your question?
You co-starred in one of my favorite Twilight Zone episodes.
Can you just step back
and,
yeah, just step back a bit, because you're getting bleeding words.
You co-starred in one of my favorite Twilight Zone episodes, A Portrait in Silver.
With
a bang-on Bostonian accent, by the way. I wanted you to comment on what that was like, and also what it was like to work with Lane Smith.
Great. It's one of my favorite episodes. For those of you who don't know this, this is a new Twilight Zone. I played JFK, and the premise is that what happens is that JFK is now...
He stole my question.
What?
He stole my question.
You know something? There's no patent on questions. Anyway, so the thing is about that is that the upshot of it is that JFK, because of a transference between he and a journalist, The journalist is the one who's killed in Dallas, and JFK is living in the future. And it's an amazing concept. And it was a beautiful script. The salvagist came up, excuse me. Well, you're not standing near me. I have the onions. Anyway, so it was a beautiful script, and it was, and being a New England Mick, you know, the Boston accent came naturally, and it was a pleasure. It was really a pleasure. When I first got the job, however, I thought, oh man, I can't do that. I'm not that guy. I could do Bobby, you know? I had my fellow Americans. But not John. And the guy said, no, do it. We'll be okay. And it's some of the proudest work I've ever done. I mean, you know, it really is. It was like a lot of fun. And Lane Smith is one of the most easy, one of the most natural actors I have ever worked with. He's a joy. And he's an old friend, too. And he's one of the craziest men I've ever met as well. But, you know, crazy is attracted to crazy and contrary. All right, come on, get up. He stole your question by asking another question. Come on, where are you? He's gone. Come on, get up here. Ask your question. Come on. I mean, listen, you're valuable, you know, you're a squeaky wheel and so forth. Go ahead, what?
Dang, too late.
Listen, thank you. He stole your question, that's it. But you guys are great. Thank you for supporting the charities. That's what I, you know, thank you for supporting me as an actor, because without your support, without you people being fans, inviting me here, there would be no Garrick, there would be no Star Trek, and all of us recognize that, all of us on the show. And God bless.